Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick here in the Philippines. I've been here minding my own business, seeking the Lord, praying, and the Lord just won't let me escape making this video, brothers and sisters. I have another message to give from the Lord, as I mentioned in the video I loaded earlier. An indictment of the Laodicean church is a message that the Lord gave me. The Lord has given me that message, and I will make that video as the Lord would anoint me to make it, because I know it, but it's not in my spirit. Those of you who are spirit-filled and you've ever served the Lord and done anything for the Lord, you know what I mean. I can say it now, but it's not quickened by the Spirit, then it's just flat. It reminds me of back there in North Carolina. I visited the largest church in my area there. It's a Southern Baptist church, and they started to where they were trying to sing these Pentecostal songs, and some of the same songs we had been singing in the church I came from, in the Assemblies of God church. And then because they had some special visitors, I went there, and it's just flat. I've talked about this before. It's just like seeing things in black and white versus color, listening to anointed worship versus unanointed worship. So the mistake that religious people make is they think it's the song or even the Bible itself. The Bible says that the Bible is spiritually discerned. It says it's the word, brings death, but it's the Spirit that quickeneth. It's the Spirit that brings life. So it's the word filled with the Spirit that brings life. And so I wanted to say something on here because there was one or two people who had messaged me. I might even be one person with different accounts, but I've been using the expression about people in the shallow end of the pool, and that's the kind of people I'm talking about. I'm not talking about new believers. I'm not talking about baby believers. When I first got saved and started walking with the Lord, I was ready to dive into the deep end of the pool. I was seeking the deeper things of God, even though you don't learn it in a day. Lots of people who are brand new believers are hungry and thirsty for righteousness. They're hungry and thirsty for the things of God, and they're ready to go into the deep end. What I mean by shallow end of the pool people, I'm talking about is myself. I have a relative who is 88 years old, been a Christian since she was 7 years old, but believes that the gifts of the Spirit and all that are not for today, who says that dreams are from the Old Testament, where the Bible clearly says that in the last days I'll pour out my Spirit on all flesh. Peter even quoted it in the books of Acts, chapter 2, that your old man would dream dreams and your young man would have visions, as an example. Those are the people who are on the shallow end of the pool, people that didn't have a form of godliness but deny the power thereof, who think with their carnal mind, not with their spirit. I met lots of good people in the States, and I met a few who think carnal minded. When they hear the word of God, they're thinking with their flesh. Up here, they have mental assent that Jesus is the Christ, mental assent, to the gospel, but it's not in their spirit, it's not quickened. Anyway, brothers and sisters, I've been minding my own business, seeking God, praying, stuff like that, and the Lord has given me these Bible texts, and He gave me some Bible texts. I know exactly what He's talking about. I've been trying to pretend like I didn't. The Lord is leading me back to talk about this Rabbi Keturah. I don't really care about that stuff, but the Lord does, brothers and sisters. I don't, but the Lord does. I'm a reluctant servant of God, and even the first time I preached, I didn't want to preach. And then the thing about it, people that love to get up there and get attention and be a showman, those are the ones that have the biggest trouble with this pride going before a fall. I'm not perfect by no means, brothers and sisters, but I'm the type of person I don't want to get in front of people and start talking. And that's the way we should always be. We should always be reluctant. I'm only getting up there because the Lord told me to. First time I preached, that's what I said. I've got my notes. I used to make notes when I first started out. I said I'd rather be home watching a football game on Sunday night than be up here. First time I preached in public was on a Sunday night. It was in the last Sunday in February 2001. It was the first time that I preached a sermon. And publicly, besides Sunday school, I've been teaching Sunday school for a couple of months, but anyway, brothers and sisters, the Lord wants me to continue to talk about this Rabbi Keturah. I just want to say this. Number one, there's someone who put a video of one. It says, former student or student of this Rabbi Keturah is a Christian, okay, and he's interviewed on there. And I guess people, because they don't pay attention or they're not looking at it, they see that Rabbi Keturah, like, this guy got saved because of Rabbi Keturah. That's not true. If you listen to this guy, he actually taught in Rabbi Keturah's, whatever, they don't call it seminary, but the equivalent of, you know, the school that he had there, the Kabbalist school, which Kabbalist is like magic. Kabbalist is the opposite of biblical Judaism or biblical Christianity. It's mystical magic, and really the root of the New Age movement. He said that he found out Jesus was the Messiah because this other man who's in the video, who's a Messianic Jew, led him, you know, and preached him and taught him and showed him that Jesus is the Messiah. Then he had a personal encounter with the Lord in the middle of the night. He came to the, you know, the illumination in his mind and his spirit that Jesus is the Christ, and he was resurrected. And what he said is that Rabbi Keturah believed that Jesus was the Messiah, but he did not believe in the resurrection. Okay, so that's a different text. But 1 Corinthians chapter 15, which I wasn't going to look at right now, but it's just since I just alluded to it. 1 Corinthians chapter 15. Maybe I've got the verses up here in front of me. Yeah, it says 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 13. If there be no resurrection of the dead, then Christ is not risen. And if Christ be not risen, then our preaching, then is our preaching vain, and your faith is also vain. Yea, we are found false witnesses of God, because we have testified of God that He raised up Christ, whom He raised not up, if so be that the dead rise not. For if the dead rise not, then is not Christ risen. And if Christ be not raised, your faith is in vain. Ye are yet in your sins. Okay, so Paul tells us if there is no resurrection of the dead, he's talking about resurrection of the dead, because the Sadducees didn't believe in the resurrection of the dead. That's why they're sad, you see. The Pharisees did, but they thought they were the only ones who were good, and that's why they were not afraid, you see, to everybody else, that only they, their sect, was could be right with God. Okay, so Paul is saying without the resurrection of Christ, you are still in your sins. So this Rabbi Keturah said, and his, one of his students, who's a man like in his 50s, who's a rabbi, who's now a Messianic Jew, who got saved through the teaching of a Messianic Jew, not from Rabbi Keturah, he says that Rabbi Keturah taught that Jesus was the Messiah, but there was no resurrection, that he was not resurrected. So therefore, people would still be in their sins. And that is not the gospel. The gospel is what? That Jesus was died for our sins. He was born of a virgin, died of his sins, and what? It says that on the third day he resurrected. That's part of the gospel. That's the main point of the gospel. He overcame death, hell, and the grave. Without the resurrection, there is no gospel. Okay, now here I am minding my own business, and the Lord had given me this other text just yesterday. And I didn't read it last. I didn't see the connection. The Lord gave me this text, and I was like, well, I was reading over it, and I thought he was talking about the Judaizers. I didn't see the connection. And then tonight, while I was praying just 5 minutes ago, the Lord gave me another word, albeit from Ezekiel. So I said, I got to look that up. Let's look at this Titus first. Chapter 1. Titus chapter 1. This is the text the Lord gave me yesterday. For there are many unruly and vain talkers and deceivers, especially they of the circumcision. You talk about deception and wacky and new age and demonic Kabbalism. They of the circumcision, this is the Jewish people, whose mouths must be stopped, who subvert whole houses, teaching things which they ought not, for filthy lucre's sake. That Rabbi Keturah said that Jesus didn't know he was the Messiah. He said that he talked about the Spirit coming on somebody and becoming the Messiah and all this stuff. I quoted it in the video yesterday. Go look up what all he actually said. One of themselves, even besides, here's a witness who's one of his students who says that he said that there is, you know, Jesus didn't resurrect from the dead. That right there is enough to say, hey, that's a different gospel. That's not the gospel message. The root of the gospel message is the resurrection of Christ. Verse 12, one of themselves, even a prophet of their own, of the Jewish people, said the Cretans are also liars, evil beasts, slow bellies. This witness is true. Don't worry about that part. Listen, you know, that's just what he's talking about in that topic, because Titus was an apostle or a preacher or a pastor or a bishop there to the on the island of Crete, the Cretans. This witness is true. Therefore, rebuke them sharply that they may be sound in the faith. Listen to this. This is the part that the Lord gave me. I just read that other part just to get an outline here of what we're talking about. Verse 14, Titus chapter 1. Not giving heed to Jewish fables and commandments of men that turn from the truth. Unto the pure all things are pure. That's us, the church, in grace. But unto them that are defiled and unbelieving is nothing pure. They're unbelieving that Jesus is the Messiah and he raised from the dead on the third day, according to the scriptures. That's the gospel laid out to us by Paul in 1 Corinthians, that he was resurrected on the third day according to the scriptures. But even their mind and consciousness is defiled. They profess that they know God, but in works they deny him, being abominable and disobedient unto every good work, reprobate. See, they deny him in their works. Jesus said, if you deny me before men, I will deny you before the Father and his angels. Now, the Lord gave me that text yesterday, and I knew, I wasn't sure in the beginning exactly what I was ready to after I made that video. I knew this was in my spirit that the Lord wanted me to say this last night. You know, I kind of held off to reconfirm that, and then the Lord's been on me all day about this. I was like, look, I don't want to get into this because there's people on YouTube who chat with me. You know, I'm nothing against any of these people personally. This is nothing personal. We're talking about the Word of God. We're talking about the gospel. This is nothing personal between people. This is just doctrine. This is just words. This is just vanity in the flesh. This has nothing to do with our relationship as Christians. This has nothing to do with the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. This is people who are, there's two groups. There are people who are desperately dying to set a date for when the rapture is going to be, because their situation is so dire in this world that the only thing they can think about 24 hours a day is a rapture, instead of going forward and doing what God would have them do in their life. Number two, there's a group of people that worship Jews, worship Israel, and they'll do anything to bow down and exalt the flesh, natural seed of Abraham versus the spiritual seed of Abraham. The Bible says that circumcision is of no effect. Those who live and follow the Lord and the Lord Jesus Christ are the spiritual children of Abraham. These are the ones who are really circumcised in heart, not in the flesh. But there's people who make an idol out of Israelis, make an idol out of Judaism. They want to be Jews. They want to worship Judaism. Whereas the Jews are the ones who said, let the blood of Jesus be upon our heads and upon the heads of our children. They rejected their Messiah. Now their day's coming. It's called the tribulation period. It's not about us. I made a video 2 or 3 years ago. The tribulation is not about us. It's not about the church. And it's not about the Gentile world. It's about Israel. The 70th week of Daniel, the time of Jacob's trouble. Different names for it. The strange work of Elohim. That's the tribulation period. Now, tonight, while I was praying, I'm minding my own business, trying not to make this video because I know there's people that really are leached on to this thing. They're latched on to this new age, old age, Kabbalist, magic, Rothschild, New World Order, foundation, religion of Kabbalism. They're latched on to this thing. Jesus said John the Baptist was the greatest of the Old Testament prophets. He was more than a prophet. But he who is least in the kingdom of heaven, the least born-again Christian, is greater than John the Baptist, Jesus tells us in the Gospel of Matthew. A Gentile Christian who just got saved 5 minutes ago is greater than the greatest rabbi that ever walked this earth that wasn't born again. That's exactly what Jesus said. Why do you think Jesus cursed the fig tree because it had no fruit on it? May you bear fruit no more. What about, did you ever read these parables and pay attention? Jesus told them there in to the Sadducees, to the Pharisees, to the religious leader, to the Sanhedrin, to all those leaders right there in the temple, outside the temple there in Jerusalem when he went up there. He said that he told the parable of taking the vineyard from one group of people and giving it to another. He told parable after parable after parable about a tree that didn't bear fruit, that needed to be cut down and cast into the fire. He was talking about the nation of Israel, what they had, their position as walking on earth as the light of the world was taken and given to the church. The Jewish time, the Israeli day, is coming again. We're going into that. In the natural there now since 1948, 1967, they took back Jerusalem. Their day will come. during the tribulation period. We are in the church age, when it's all about being born again and being a child of God through the blood of Jesus. That's it. That's the gospel. It had nothing to do with anything where you're born, as Jesus told one of their leaders, Nicodemus, John chapter 3. Except a man be born again, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. John 3:3. God, for God so loved the world, not just Israel, God so loved all people. Abraham wasn't Jewish. His grandson, great-grandson, was Judah. Abraham wasn't Jewish. All those people before that, Enoch and all those guys, they weren't Hebrews. Adam wasn't a Hebrew. Adam wasn't a Jew. All of those people before that, they're Gentiles. There was no such thing as Jews until Judah was born. Israel, his father, Jacob, had his name changed to Israel. That's one group of people that God dealt with to give us the law, to bring us to this knowledge of sin and death, that nobody's perfect. All have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. How do we know that? Because look at the nation of Israel. They're an example to us. We are an example to Israel to provoke them to jealousy, that we're saved by grace through faith, not of our own, but a gift of God, not by works, lest any man should boast. This is the word that the Lord gave me tonight. Out of the blue, as I said, the word albeit from Ezekiel. So I looked it up on Esort, right here, verse 7. Have ye not seen a vain vision, and have ye not spoken a lying divination? Whereas ye say, the Lord say it, albeit I have not spoken. And I want to read, the Lord wants me to read this whole thing. Verse 1, Ezekiel 13, verse 1. And the word of the Lord came unto me, saying, Son of man, prophesy against the prophets of Israel that prophesy, and say thou unto them that prophesy out of their own hearts, hear ye the word of the Lord. Thus says the Lord God, woe unto foolish prophets that follow their own spirit and have seen nothing. O Israel, thy prophets are like the foxes in the desert. Ye have not gone up unto the gaps, neither made up the hedge of the house of Israel to stand in the battle in the day of the Lord. Tribulation period. They have seen vanity and lying divination, saying, the Lord saith, and the Lord hath not sent them. And they have made others to hope that they would confirm the word. That's what it is. People running around on YouTube confirming the word that started out that's not true. As I mentioned yesterday, P.P. Simmons, as far as I know, they're the first ones. At Carl Gallup, with all their crazy theology. The Lord wants me to mention this. I didn't want to get into it because people keep copying and pasting and hearing all this stuff about, I saw Barack Obama falling like lightning from the sky. Jesus, that original Bible text was written in Greek. Not Aramaic, not in Hebrew. The New Testament was written in Greek. There are hundreds of ancient biblical scholars who were experts in these things, some Christians, some Jews, some atheists, who are linguistic experts. This is their life and job to know if this text was the original wording or if it was translated from another text. They can tell by the syntax and all this stuff whether a text was in a different language, the idioms and all that. The New Testament was written to the world. God so loved the world. The apostles brought the good news to the world. The international language was Greek. Just like today, if the Bible came out today, the international language is English. English, English. In those days, it was Greek. The New Testament was written in Greek. These are, confirmed, overwhelming evidence, scientific facts that can easily be researched, and their experts have given their life to just these things, and that is the consensus of all of them. Verse 6, I don't know where I was at. Ezekiel 13:6. They have seen vanity and lying divination, saying, the Lord saith, the Lord have not sent them. They have made others to hope that they would confirm the word. Have ye not seen a vain vision? Have ye not spoken a lying divination? Whereas you say, the Lord say it, albeit I have not spoken. Therefore saith, I don't even want to read that. This is a judgment of the Lord. That's for Israel. It's not for us. That's specifically for Israel. The Lord quicken this word, what I just gave you from Him. I do not want to make a video about what Rabbi Keturah said. I could care less what Rabbi Keturah said or not said. the Lord is leading me to get on this. I don't want to be on this, but I am because the Lord has said, stand on it. And so I am. So we all have things to do. Just like when I came to the Philippines, I've been here for this is the seventh year I've been here in the Philippines. In my flesh, I don't want to be in the Philippines. In the flesh, I do not want to be here. But I've been here for 7 years because that's what God called me to do. Now, I am not perfect. I am not God. I'm just a man. But surely by the grace of God, you can see that I can be an example to you of sacrifice for the Lord. There are so many people, and thank the Lord is only a few that have aggravated me. I would say not even a handful, just one or two. But it only takes, you know, one or two grapes to make them all sour. You know what I'm saying? That can get on your get you, try to knock you down. One or two rotten grapes. Sitting back in the States, enjoying their comfort, living in their, you know, fat and happy life, and enjoying themselves and all of this, and then just sitting around spouting and debating doctrine, never done anything for the Lord. Only just sitting back and you know, when you say something people don't agree with, then they're just looking for any little nitpick thing to attack you. I know those people. And I say, in my flesh, I want to just, you know, be moved by people, you know, want me to be just like Joel Osteen. But in my spirit, in my obedient heart, so far, by the grace of God, I'm not perfect. But I've been a whole lot more obedient than 90% of the people that you're going to meet to come over to the Philippines and be a missionary. There's lots of people called, but they don't do it. Just keep sitting around talking about it. Lots of you guys. Oh, you know, I know the Lord wants me to do this, but no, but you want to do your own will. You didn't say, Lord, let your will be done. You say, well, you know, Lord, I want to do my own will. I know you called me to go be a missionary in Ethiopia or Afghanistan or whatever, but hey, I'm going to let my own will be done. Not your will, but my will be done. You said no. So the thing that we need to do, we all make mistakes every day. We need to repent of them and go on. Repent of them and then do right. Repent of them and do right. This reminds me of something that the Lord said. He talked to the Jews and the Israelites there, and he said, a man has two sons. He says to the first son, go feed the pigs. And he says, I will. But then he doesn't go. He didn't say pigs, as a matter of fact, because it's against the law to eat pork. But he said, you know, go and work in my vineyard. And he said, no, I will do it. And he didn't. That was the nation of Israel that Jesus was talking about. The second group, the Gentiles, Jesus said to his second son, go work in the vineyard. And he said, I will not. But later he did. Now, which of his sons was obedient to his father? They said, oh, the second son. That's right. That's the Gentiles. That's why he says, therefore the kingdom will be taken from you and given to another. It's the Gentiles. That's us. So all of you who have initially said no to the Lord, today is the day for you to say yes. Today is the day for you to say yes. Now, when the Spirit of the Lord comes upon you, those people that are convicted, I know you guys, you've been out there talking to your backslidden and your non-Christian relatives, and you know they'll say, oh, you think you're better than us. Don't listen to those people. Don't listen to those people. If you have to be perfect to preach, no one would have ever been able to preach but Jesus. The Apostle Paul consented to the killing of Stephen, one of the most holiest, righteous, greatest Christians that ever lived. Stephen was stoned, and Paul was consenting to that, and he held the jackets of those who stoned him. So Moses killed somebody, and yet God brought him back, and God used him as the greatest voice in the Old Testament, the greatest leader in the Old Testament, who the Jews see as like almost a Messiah. It's Moses. The greatest man in the Old Testament, Moses, was a murderer. Don't let these old Pharisees, that's what they do. They try to bring up your past. You know what that is? I'll tell you what that is. It's exactly what that is. It's the voice. It's a demonic spirit that tries to accuse you of your past. Because Jesus said, don't call anything unclean that I've called clean. Now, if you're born again, if you truly repented and became born again, you are clean. Washed in the blood of Jesus. Washed by the Word. Washed by the Spirit of the living God. Jesus said, you're washed in my Word. His blood cleanses us of all unrighteousness. Don't let anybody try to put a yoke back on you, try to remind you of your past. The Bible says that as far as from the east as from the west, so shall your sins be from you. Though you be your sins be like scarlet red, they shall be white like wool. Even though they be like crimson, they shall be white as the snow. Isaiah chapter 1. God's blood cleanses us of all unrighteousness. 1 John 1, 9, if we Christians confess our sins, he is just and faithful to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us of all unrighteousness. We are cleansed, washed in the blood. The Lord remembers our sin no more. So if someone tries to accuse you of your sin, that is the Bible talks about the accuser of the brethren who accuses us night and day before the Lord. In the book of Revelation, it talks about, you know who that is? That's the slanderer, the destroyer. That is Satan and his minions, the demons. So when someone who, a non-believer, tries to accuse you of your past, bring up something that you repented of, there's only one spirit where they're doing that. That's from the enemy, from the devil. Don't listen to that lying spirit. Raise your voice and speak boldly like John the Baptist did. Raise your voice and speak as the Spirit of the Lord would lead you. And don't let any man try to keep you down. I even had, you know, even with money, even this time in the States, I've never had it where people was trying to, you better watch what you say. Then you won't get that money, that funding for Joshua's ministry. Hey, Joshua's ministry came into existence by the working of the power of the Holy Spirit. And if Joshua's ministry leaves this world tomorrow, it is by the working and the power of the Holy Spirit. It's God's ministry to sustain or not sustain, to shut down or make it 100 times bigger. That's totally up to the Lord. It's not my ministry, it's God's ministry. So it doesn't move me. All I know is I have to please God and move in the will of God, not men. And that's why I made a strong video when I first came back to the Philippines, and I didn't load it. But the message is, and the message is for this example right here about this divination, just like the girl that followed Paul and them divined that they were the sons of God, you know, they were bringing the gospel. And then also the Magi who divined by non-unlawful supernatural sources that the king of the Jews had been born in Bethlehem. They didn't know where. Actually, the rabbis told them where in Bethlehem, but they knew it was in Israel. The king of the Jews had been born in Israel, and they came to worship him by divination. And then they found out from the rabbis where, according to the Bible, where he would be born. They didn't have a copy of the Bible. They did it by some other extra-biblical information. They divined it. So the message is we can't compromise. This is what, you know, the whole message of the letters to the churches in Revelation is about compromise. And that's the whole video. This is just leading in. Let me just end with this. To the video the Lord given me about the indictment of the Laodicean church, which is the church age we're living in just prior to the rapture and tribulation period. Compromise, compromise, compromise. People keep talking about the Roman Catholics, about what happened, Council of Nicaea and all that stuff, and all the things it introduced to pagan religion into Catholicism. Compromise with the devil and his doctrines for financial benefit or whatever. Financial benefit, power, more members, all that stuff. All the other churches, almost 100%, are doing the same thing. Right now, even Assemblies of God churches, Church of God churches, Baptist, whoever they are, they're building their own kingdom. They're tickling people's ears. That's why when people heard me preach, a few people, as I said, less than a handful, as a matter of fact, one or two, they don't like it. They're like, oh, you're ranting. No, you just never heard preaching before. You've never heard Holy Ghost preach. I haven't heard preaching myself. When I was a little kid in the 70s, I heard one or two times that I was taken to church. I heard some real preaching. I haven't heard any preaching since then. Nobody's been preaching hard. I mean, there's some. I'm sure there's some. I haven't heard them. That's preaching the Word by the Spirit. It's not sold out and compromised. I'm not the only one, but there's not many. Most of the people are compromised. They're sold out. They're trying to promote themselves, build their own kingdom. Look, the devil uses different things, okay? You got the Catholic Church with the Mary worship, and then the Pope is wearing the big Dagon God, Dagon fish hat, the hat shaped like the mouth of a fish. That's from Dagon worship. They got all this pompous robes and all this stuff. You got other denominations like the whatever, the Presbyterians and all them. They got the gay, lesbian, woman bishop or whatever. That's what they sold out for. They compromised for that. Something different, but still compromised. The devil comes in all these different shades of gray. Talk about when I was in the States, I heard the number one book or whatever is this 50 Shades of Gray. The devil's got 1,000 shades of gray. Just compromise this much. As he told Jesus, Matthew chapter 4, I believe it's around in there, verse 16 or whatever. He says, maybe a little bit, few verses before that. He said, you know, if you'll bow down and worship me, all the kingdoms, he showed Jesus all the kingdoms in a moment, all the kingdoms of the world from the beginning of time to the end, all this will be yours if you bow down and worship me. So that's Satan compromising and tempting religious leaders or anybody. Hey, just like he does individuals. Hey, just look at a little porno on the internet. You can look at a little porno where nobody. He does the same thing to a denomination, to a church group. Hey, let me come in and give you some money and build you a big church. And then, hey, you know, here's my doctrine. Here's my special thing. I want to insert it into your doctrine. I have people trying to do that to me in the States. Just add this part. You know, and then, hey, we can build more orphanages or whatever. See, that's where the compromise comes in. Into an individual, to a denomination. It's all the same. It's the same old liar. It's the same old slanderer. The same old accuser of the brethren. The same spirit that tempts you to look at pornography is the same spirit that will try to expose you and embarrass you and shame you and accuse you. Same spirit. Lead you to sin, then drag you where you don't want to go, and then be the first one to throw the first stone at you. That's the devil. That's the devil. Know your enemy. The Bible says we are not ignorant of his devices. I'll make this video. Don't be sitting around cheering that Ariel Sharon is going to die. I told you, I give you a true word from the Lord, as I mentioned in the last video. Bad times is coming for the nation of Israel, which we all know the Bible clearly tells us that. There's nothing special about that. But that's what's coming. Whenever these divination voices come forward and say something about Jesus being the Christ and all this, as I mentioned those biblical examples, all hell is about to break loose in that situation. And Israel is facing that today. We need to pray for Israel, for their conversion to Jesus Christ. We need to pray for Israel that God will have mercy on them as they face the time of Jacob's trouble, a.k.a. the tribulation period, as they're about to divide their land on a peace deal with the Antichrist. And no, we do not know who the Antichrist is. We do not know who he is. There is one who stands in the place of Christ, and it's not a president of a country. As a matter of fact, it's in Rome, if you want to look at candidates, even though I don't think it's him either. God bless you guys. I got to go. I'm already over 30 minutes. I will make that indictment of the Laodicean church as the Lord has commanded me. And it stands as a record. These things, when you speak a true word from God, it goes out as a record. As a record. Its own record. Condemnation. From the word of God. That he who has an ear, let him hear. We, all of us, whoever, if you're in any one of these churches or whatever, including, you know, like myself, whoever we are, we need to repent and come out from among them. Be ye holy, for I am holy. That's what God wants us to do. Come out from among these old dead religions. They're about to be thrown into the tribulation. Don't be caught unawares. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. We are not children of the night, but children of the day. You know, that day of the rapture and tribulation will not overtake us as a thief. Because we're in the light, not in the dark, like those people that choose to be in the dark. God has called us to light by His Spirit and by His Word. Not by any denomination or religion. All these things are from the enemy. God bless you guys.